Good morning. You know, since our coffee was late this morning due to the power outage, if you would like to get up during the service and help yourself to the coffee, you do that. Please stand as you are able to, for a call to worship. The glory of God shines like a consuming fire. We have seen the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. The voice of God thunders like a mighty storm. Out of the cloud, God speaks, "This is my beloved Son. Listen to him. Come, let us worship God."
The clouds of sin. Please be seated.
God alone is righteous. God alone is perfect. God alone is judge. Yet this holy, righteous God comes to us in love to save us. Rejoicing in God's grace, let us confess our sin. Please join me in our unison prayer of confession. God of all glory, beauty, and grace, we have tried to hide from you, to hide our faces, to hide our sin, yet you have never hidden your love for us. We have tried to search for you in temples, in clouds, on mountaintops, yet you have already revealed yourself to us in the face of Jesus Christ. Forgive us and transform us so that our lives may shine with your glory, beauty, and grace. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. God comes and does not keep silence. God speaks to us with grace and love, saying, "You are my beloved child." This is the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Let us pass the peace of Christ.
The count can just be a little louder. Oh,
join to sing hallelujah, amen.
Loud praise to Christ our King, hallelujah, amen. Let all with heart and voice before his throne rejoice. Praise is his gracious choice, hallelujah, amen.
The God who speaks and summons the earth into being now speaks to us, calling us to offer up our lives as a sacrifice of praise. Will the ushers please come forward?
We're singing for offertory this morning, Confet Peace, the Majesty and Glory of Your Name. This is the very first anthem that we sung on February 7th, 2021.
When I give
Gracious God, we give you thanks for the light of love around us and the fire of faith within us. As we go forth from this place, let our lives reflect the one who is the image of your glory, Jesus Christ, the light of the world. Amen. Amen. Please be seated. Our first reading is from the book of 2 Kings, chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. Hear now the word of our Lord. Now when the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven by a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. And Elijah said to Elisha, "Please stay here, for the Lord has sent me as far as Bethel." But Elisha said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they went down to Bethel. And the sons of the prophets who were in Bethel came out to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take away your master from over you?" And he said, "Yes, I know it. Keep quiet." Elijah said to him, "Elisha, please stay here, for the Lord has sent me to Jericho." But he said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they came to Jericho. The sons of the prophets who were at Jericho drew near to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take away your master from over you?" And he answered, "Yes, I know it. Keep quiet." Then Elisha said to him, "Please stay here, for the Lord has sent me to the Jordan." But he said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So the two of them went on. 50 men of the sons of the prophets also went and stood at some distance from them, as they both were standing by the Jordan. Then Elijah took his cloak and rolled it up and struck the water. And the water was parted to the one side and to the other, till the two of them could go over on dry ground. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "Ask what I shall do for you before I am taken from you." And Elisha said, "Please let there be a double portion of your spirit on me." And he said, "You have asked a hard thing. Yet if you see me as I am being taken from you, it shall be so for you. But if you do not see me, it shall not be so." And as they still went on and talked, behold, chariots of fire and horses of fire separated the two of them. And Elijah went up by a whirlwind into heaven. And Elisha saw it, and he cried, my father, the chariots of Israel and its horsemen." And he saw him no more. Then he took hold of his own clothes and tore them in two pieces. The word of our Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Speak to us, O Lord our God, and let the fire of your Spirit burn brightly in our hearts. Open our minds to receive the wisdom of the law, the hope of the prophets, and the life of the gospel. Jesus Christ, your living word. Amen. The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 9th chapter. Hear now the gospel of the Lord. And after 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and led them up a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became radiant, intensely white, as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah and Moses, and they were talking with Jesus. And Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good that we are here. Let us make three tents, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." For he did not know what to say, for they were terrified. and a cloud overshadowed them, and the voice came out of the cloud, "This is my beloved Son. Listen to him." Suddenly, looking around, they saw no one any longer except Jesus only. And as they were coming down the mountain, he charged them to tell no one what he had seen until the Son of Man had been risen from the dead. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Say this morning is, isn't that music fantastic?
Yes.
It's just wonderful. Thank you, everybody. Oh, and David, it's really nice having you sitting behind me playing. I really appreciate that very much. Katie, thank you so much for being back with us again this week and playing once again. Let's pray. Holy Lord Jesus, may we all receive a double share of your spirit as Elisha received his from Elijah. Use us, Almighty God, as servants and stewards of the gospel. Amen. Oh, happy anniversary, everyone. Whether you've been here 3 years or 3 weeks or even just a week, it makes no difference. Please join us for the cake and coffee after the service this morning. We would really appreciate having the opportunity to fellowship for a time then as well. This is a sermon about Elijah. It's also a sermon about Elisha, that great prophet that followed Elijah. It's also a sermon about Jesus and his transfiguration. And of course, we have to mention at least that other great Moses, as he's in the gospel text for today. And by the time we conclude this morning, we'll talk a little bit about you and me too. These two prophets, Elijah and Elisha, were like father and son. In fact, you heard that father, father at the end of the passage that Lindy read a few moments ago. But they were very different. Elijah was a very powerful man, a man who could and did pronounce the wrath of God on kings. And when Elisha did announce the fall of the house of Ahab, you remember Ahab and Jezebel, his ministry was quite different. Just an aside, someday I would like to have the opportunity to preach a whole sermon on Ahab and Jezebel. They're a fascinating couple, and while their example is very negative, it's also one that I'm sure we all can relate to. Now, oh yes, there is sin in all of us, right? Now, just as Elijah was feared and revered, Elisha was loved and appreciated. He was made welcome in many of the homes of Israel. As time progressed, the day of Elijah's departure from this earth finally came. Our first reading this morning that Lindy did so well was giving an account of what happened that day. So you've all heard that. So you're going to get a little redundancy here, but not a whole lot, I hope. Elisha knew something big was about to happen. He knew his master was going to be taken from him. How he didn't really know for sure, I don't think, until it actually happened. But at the same time, he knew it was going to happen. And while Elijah kept saying, wait here, I'm going to go on. No, Elisha wouldn't have any of it. Let's take a look at some of the occurrences of that day and see how they might apply to the transfiguration of our Lord. On that day, Elisha was asked what one request he would have of Elijah before he passed on into heaven. Now, only God can grant certain requests. But as I said a minute ago, Elisha's apprenticeship was over, and the old prophet knew his protege so well that he knew he wouldn't ask anything that was not in the center of God's will. But look at the request. Was Elisha a carrier of spiritual greed? Did he want something God couldn't give? In the Old Testament times, and even in the early New Testament era, the eldest son always received a double share of the inheritance. That is what Elisha is asking for here. The elder son got a double share, and all of the other sons got a single share of the estate. So if there were five sons, it was divided by six. The eldest got two, and the rest of them got the other four. And ladies, I'm sorry, but they just got married off. It really wasn't quite fair. But that custom is illustrated very well in the story of Jacob and his 12 sons. The eldest son, Reuben, had committed what was tantamount to incest and was therefore, he lost his right of firstborn. And since Joseph was the firstborn of his other wife, Joseph received a double share. Now, there's no tribe named Joseph, if you all know, but remember Ephraim and Manasseh, the two sons of Joseph were the two other tribes of Israel. And as you well know, there were never 13 tribes because the Levites themselves only received the commission to be priests. Well, I wouldn't say only. They received the commission to be priests of the Most High God. Elisha was not being spiritually greedy. He merely wanted to receive the rights of the firstborn son of Elijah. And of course, from our text today, we know what happened next. He was told that if he could see Elijah's transformation into heaven, that his request would be granted. Now, it takes a special kind of person to see the movements of God. And Elisha was certainly one of those individuals. I mean, after all, look at the rest of his life and what happened. This man really was in tune with Almighty God. And of course, he saw the transition that took place. And after it was done, he picked up Elijah's cloak and walked off. It was his now. Now, the wearing of a man's cloak in ancient times was an unmistakable sign of inheriting that man's position. But today on Transfiguration Sunday, we see Elijah once again, this time talking to Jesus and Moses. Now back to Elisha and Elijah. Elisha's life was very different from Elijah. He soon became known as the hermit by the way, or hermit by the road. There were 9 miracles during his tenure. All of them were acts of mercy. You may remember that one in particular, the raising of the Shunammite woman's son from death. The woman and her husband had been barren, and they had been very kind to Elisha. Whenever he was in that area, they put him up, they fed him, they just took care of him. And Elisha saw that she was barren and prayed to God that she should have a son. Well, she had a son. And later that son died. And she called on Elisha saying, "You know, I never asked for a son, but now that I have one, why has he been taken away from me?" And Elisha prayed and brought new life into that son. Compare the works of Elijah. He was a man of great power. When Israel fell into Baal worship, and that of Ashtaroth, by the way, also, he challenged the 450 priests of Baal to a spiritual duel. They set up 2 altars. They put bulls on both altars. And then Elijah said to the priests of Baal, "Okay, no fire. You pray to your God to bring fire down on the altar, and we'll see what happens." And they prayed, and they prayed, and they prayed all day. And about noon, Elijah starts to taunt them. Maybe he's asleep. Pray a little louder. And, you know, this kind of stuff was going on throughout the day. And finally, after nothing happened, Elijah said, "We'll dig a trench around my altar, and let's pour gallons and gallons of water on it. I'll show you what God can do here." And indeed, after the trench was dug and the water was poured, he basically said, "Okay, God, Father of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, show them." And God did. Fire came down and consumed the bull and all of the water and the altar. And of course, this time the prophets of Baal were not really very pleased, but Elijah called the people to bring them down to the creek, the Kidron. And when they got down there, he killed all of them. The priests of Baal died that day because they did not follow our God. And believe it or not, Elijah ran from a woman. But what a woman. Jezebel. That name just kind of rolls off, doesn't it? Jezebel. She'd introduced the cults of Baal and Ashtaroth into the people of Israel. She had led the people to stray. And Ahab didn't do a thing about it. He was just as guilty as she was. And have you heard someone say something like, "That woman is a Jezebel"? That's not a very good compliment, is it? Have you heard that? Anybody? Yeah, quite a few. By the way, the last part of Jezebel is Bel, or Baal. She was named after her god. And she was the one that encouraged the worship of Baal and Asherah in Israel, as I said. How little it takes to lead us astray sometimes. Now, both Ahab and Jezebel died ignominious deaths. But that's another story. That's for the other sermon if I ever get to preach it. Elisha and Elijah were very different, as I said. But they were both prophets called by God to do his will. Elisha, that man of benevolence, was even thought to be a hermit. On the other hand, Elisha spent a great deal of time in the houses of nobles. He healed, he taught, he blessed everyone he saw, and he carried forth the word of the Lord. Elijah, the prophet of the Lord, set the stage for the coming of the Messiah. Elisha was a Christ-like friend to all. Elijah set the stage. Now, what does all this have to do with the transfiguration? And with you and me? One, Jesus was transfigured to show the glory and splendor of Christ at the end of the world. Elijah was transformed before his friend to show him the reality of spiritual things. We see both of these events and have to sit back in awe of Almighty God, who performed these miracles and yet also did not spare his own son, but let him be a ransom for us all. Second, you and I are called to a ministry beside of the road, or we're called to be like Elijah, who knows? But we're called to be ministering saints nonetheless. Styles vary. Dan and I preach a little differently, but we both preach the gospel. We preach the good news of Jesus Christ and him crucified. Styles vary. But I think that makes us a great team, personally. At three, we're not called by a great man to be his people. We're called by the Son of God to be his people. And we're called to serve that God in the power of the Holy Spirit. We don't have to parcel out the Holy Spirit the way Elisha received a double portion of Elijah's spirit. When we have the Holy Spirit, we have the Holy Spirit, period. It's done. It's a given. And five, just as Elijah and Elisha were different, we can be different as well. We need not fit anyone's mold. Unity in Christ does not demand uniformity. You've heard that one many times, I'm sure. We dare not let the means get in the way of the meaning. Now, if we are to be disciples of Christ, we need one other thing that Elijah, Moses, Isaiah, all the others exemplified. We need to be totally surrendered to our Lord. This we do is we remember our baptism. Remember the phrase a few weeks ago, I have been baptized in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit into my heart. Christ is a part of our lives. The Holy Spirit is a part of our lives. The Father, of course, also. We remember this when we confess our sins. We remember it each time we receive the body and blood of our Lord in the Lord's Supper. We remember it each time we enter our church and we feel the presence of God in this wonderful place. The question each of us needs to ask this morning is simple enough. Is my heart totally surrendered to Jesus Christ? Only then can the transfiguration of our Lord have its richest and fullest expression in and through each and every one of us. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Please stand as you are able and let us affirm our faith by reading together the words of the Nicene Creed. Christians, what do you believe?
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated.
Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth. In mercy for our fallen world, you gave your only Son, that all those who believe in him should not perish, but have eternal life. We give thanks to you for the salvation you have prepared for us through Jesus Christ. Send now your Holy Spirit into our hearts, that we may receive our Lord with a living faith as he comes to us in his Holy Supper.
Amen.
Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup when he had supped and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This covenant is the new covenant of my blood, given and shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Remember this as often as you drink it."
Lord, have mercy. Prepare with all my hand of bread. O Lord, hungry and thirsty.
Let us pray. Mighty and merciful one, you have come to us in glory. Now we come to you in prayer, saying, Lord, in your spirit, we pray for your glorious creation. Stamp out fires of destruction, drive away clouds of pollution, and restore the beauty of this world, Lord, by your Spirit.
Grant what we ask.
We pray for the body of Christ. Open our hearts in faith, enlighten our minds with knowledge, and strengthen us to proclaim the gospel, Lord, by your Spirit.
Grant what we ask.
We pray for the people of all nations. Show the nations your vision of justice. Offer the leaders your mantle of wisdom and give the people your blessing of peace. Lord, by your Spirit, we pray for those who are perishing. Feed those who are starving. Comfort those who are suffering. And receive the dying into your arms. Lord, by your Spirit, we pray for those whom we love. Bless our families, friends, and neighbors. Help them in times of trouble and be near them when they are afraid. Lord, by your Spirit.
Amen.
Holy Lord God, we have many within our household of faith, as well as friends and families of our members. We pray that you would bless each and every one of them with your holy touch. Be with Sam Ochoa and his entire family. Be with Mary Short, Curtis and Lindy, Liana and Terry, Jill and Maidley, Michelle and Jasmine, Marlene, the Wolf family, Jeannie and Wade, Francis, the Wallace family, Mirka, Dick and Carolyn, Todd Herman, Susie and Mike, Ken and Diane, Iron and Susie, Emerson, Hallie Richardson, Kathy and Norm, Lisa, Rich and Katie, Laura Lee, Shirley, Fred, Ethan Zimmerman, Donna Johnson and Grace Point Church, Margie Grimm, Mike Johnson, Ruthie and Mark Spencer, and Tom and Joanne. Lord, by your Spirit, Holy One, make us ready for the day when this world is transfigured, transformed, made new, when all things will shine in the dazzling light of your glory. And now, through Christ and the power of the Holy Spirit, let us pray together that prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Go now and tell the good news. The Lord of life and light is with us. Jesus Christ is risen from the dead. Alleluia. And now, may the very face of God shine upon you with beauty, blessing, and peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.